This conference will now be recorded.
Hello and welcome to the Hospital EARC Initial Certification Training. This training is for 2022, presented to you by the New Jersey Division of Aging Services, and my name is Deanna Freundlich. So we have a lot to cover today. So let's get started here. This is our training agenda. We have put the slide numbers where you can access the information later. We do hope you use this training PowerPoint as a resource as you get comfortable with the EARC process in the portal. So we'll review the overview and target criteria, responsibilities for different disciplines, options counseling, and item by item review of the EARC, including a heavy emphasis on cognition and activities of daily living. We'll introduce the hospital EARC and provide an overview of the portal, as well as the portal record, the EARC record, provide you with direction and how to create a new hospital EARC. We'll discuss the workflow and various processing steps, discuss the certification process, as well as portal support. So let's get into the hospital EARC overview and target criteria. This is a very critical section. We ask that you review this several times as you get comfortable in your role as an EARC screener. So the hospital EARC is a screening tool. It is utilized for individuals in a hospital seeking discharge to an IF that meet the identified target population with an expectation of billing Medicaid for all or part of their nursing facility stay. Completion is required by those that have a valid certification. If authorized, the EARC does allow for reimbursement of up to 180 days of Medicaid funding to the NIF for that NIF admission, as long as the full clinical and financial eligibility has been established. All of these regulations are provided NJAC 885 to discuss the requirement for clinical eligibility, as well as the requirements for the nursing facility services. So hospital EARC logistics. Once authorized, the hospital EARC is valid for 10 days for that discharge to the nursing facility. It does allow the NIF admission within 10 days with potential Medicaid reimbursement from that date of admission. Failure to obtain an EARC for a potential Medicaid recipient will delay the OCO authorization and may result in the inability of the NIF to claim and bill Medicaid for Medicaid coverage. If the discharge does not occur from the hospital within 10 days of that authorization date, a new EARC must be submitted and processed fully. So we do have some revisions starting 11/15/2022. We are now identifying a hospital EARC being valid for NIF admission as long as the hospital EARC is not older than 6 months and there's been no break in service from the original admitting NIF. So as I said, it's a placeholder for reimbursement up to 180 days. I see it says 90 days. This is new and that needs to be changed. It's 180 days. When we say no break in service from original admitting NIF, we are identifying a break in service as a NIF resident who is hospitalized for fewer than 10 days and is returning to the same NIF. That is no break in service. If the bed hold days are exhausted, then a new EARC must be conducted prior to that discharge. What's important with this change is that the discharge planners at the hospital are in communication with the NIFs to determine if the EARC and or clinical assessment, if there's a valid assessment or EARC on file, and whether that new EARC is required. So the target population for the EARC. This is when an EARC would be appropriate. So that would be any patient discharging from an acute non-psychiatric hospital or a long-term acute care unit. And it's a new admission to a Medicaid certified NIF or Venska NIF with an expectation of billing Medicaid for all or part of their stay. So just a note there, includes NIF residents who have exhausted the 10-day bed hold and will be returning to the same NIF upon discharge. So these individuals should be currently Medicaid eligible, but not yet enrolled in New Jersey Family Care with an MCO, or they are potentially Medicaid eligible within 180 days. Some exclusions that we have outlined here, this would require an individual to have an on-site OCO clinical assessment. And that would include individuals being referred for placement in a special care nursing facility such as AIDS, behavioral units, Huntington's, neurologically impaired, pediatric, or TBI. It's only those vent SCNF transfers that are appropriate for the EARC. All other SCNFs require that on-site clinical assessment. As well, an exclusion that does require the on-site clinical assessment are those individuals in a psychiatric hospital or psychiatric acute care unit. The referral for the on-site assessment is required through the LTC-24. That form can be accessed at the following website. We have other exclusions as well that identify those individuals not eligible for an EARC nor an on-site assessment. This would be any individual seeking home and community-based waivers, returning to the community, individuals who would not qualify for Medicaid within 6 months of NIF placement, who would be considered private pay, individuals that have a valid pass on file, full clinical eligibility for Medicaid, and individuals enrolled in New Jersey Family Care with an MCO upon entrance to a hospital. If MCO enrolled, an authorization for placement must be obtained from the MCO. And I also wanted to point out, a valid pass on file means that an assessment, a full clinical eligibility assessment, has been conducted within the last 12 months. Some other exclusions where no EARC or on-site assessment is required would be an individual pending Medicaid with a valid EARC within the last 180 days and returning to the same NIF within the 10-day bed hold time period. As well, we're looking at individuals with a PASSR Level 2 determination that indicates required specialized services, individuals who are medically unstable, including those in the emergency room, as well as individuals who are not in a New Jersey hospital. Of course, there's always some gray areas, so there may be some situations outside of our eligibility parameters. If you are unclear, please outreach your respective OCO office. The counties that are covered for each office are identified there, as well as their main telephone contact. So let's discuss some responsibilities. You, as the EARC screener, holds the highest responsibility in conducting this process. So if a patient is admitted from a NIF, it is critical that you outreach that facility to determine the expiration of a 10-day bed hold and expectation to return to the same NIF. Determine the eligibility for EARC and whether a valid EARC or a pass is on file. Conduct options counseling with the patient and or legal representative prior to initiation of the EARC. We'll be discussing this more in greater detail later. Fully complete and submit the hospital EARC with the required PASSR attachments when applicable for OCO processing via the portal. Respond timely to OCO requests, which would include the inappropriate referral when there's incorrect data or a request for information. These are status updates within the portal, which you will understand as we work through this. As well, you will proceed with discharge planning as applicable to the outcome of the EARC, whether it be to the nursing facility or some other community discharge. OCO support staff, they are receiving these referrals that you're putting into the portal. They will determine if the submission is appropriate by considering whether or not there is a valid pass on file. If there is a valid pass, the EARC would not be required, and they would be identifying a status update of inappropriate referral, and that referral would be considered closed. Is the individual MCO enrolled? If yes, again, the EARC is not appropriate. You should be directly outreaching the MCO for authorization for that NIF discharge. An inappropriate referral status will be provided and the referral is closed. Is the demographic correct? If there is a conflict with the demographics that OCO has on file, They will be looking to get some validation as to the information that was entered related to demographics. And for this, they will conduct an inappropriate referral, incorrect data, for which we are expecting resubmission of the EARC once that information can be validated, changed, or just a comment to indicate that no changes were made. And then other considerations, whatever that may be, inappropriate referral would be applied and that referral would be considered closed. So in addition to understanding if the referral is appropriate, they'll update the status to assigned of if it can be processed to continue on for an OCA review and a final determination. Once an OCA determination has been applied, the support staff will conduct their final processing and update that record to complete, and therefore that record is now closed. No further processing. Our OCA reviewer holds the key to determine whether or not the patient appears to meet eligibility criteria. They are looking to conduct a review within one business day of the assigned referral, and they're looking for making sure that it's either a NIF or a VENSCA-NIF, looking at PASSAR attachments, ensuring that they've been submitted with the EARC, as well as considering the clinical eligibility, looking at both cognition and ADL and any other relevant information. If by chance they're unable to make a final determination because they feel there could be a conflict, coding doesn't appear to be correct, they will outreach the screener by identifying or updating the status to RFI for additional action. So if there's a coding discrepancy or a need for PASSAR documents or other identified issues, they will be clearly documented for your understanding. Once they are able to make that final determination, they will update the status to OCO determination, whether it be authorized, not authorized, or referral dismissed. So as I discussed when I introduced this training, options counseling is very critical to this process. So let's first define what options counseling is. It is a person-centered, interactive decision support process whereby individuals receive assistance in their deliberations to make informed long-term support choices in the context of their preferences, strengths, and values. So related to the EARC screening, options counseling is critical. This dialogue will allow you, the screener, to determine if the target criteria is met or should they be excluded from this process. Also, it's important to inform the patient and or legal representative of Medicaid programs and required processes to obtain that full Medicaid eligibility, including both financial and clinical. And also to provide alternatives to nursing facility placements, such as discharge to the community with supportive services, and when appropriate, to make referrals to explore those other programs and services. And we always recommend a referral to the Area Agencies on Aging, which are also known as the Aging and Disability Resource Connection, which is very familiar with the county resources, and an appropriate referral to share. So what kind of information are we looking to have you share? So Medicaid offers many programs. New Jersey Family Care, Age, Blind, and Disabled is just one. It is for people that need long-term services and supports. We'll be discussing that a little bit here. Medicaid financial eligibility conducted by the CWA. There's a website there that provides all of the contact information, encouraging your patients and their representatives to initiate and or complete the application for financial eligibility. We have provided a handout, what you need to know about when applying for Medicaid. It would be a handy resource to share with your patient so that they know what to expect, what documentation is required to file that application. Medicaid long-term services and supports. This is long-term services for individuals in nursing facilities or in the community. We have two separate programs under long-term services and supports. The first being Program of All-Inclusive Care for the Elderly, also referred to as PACE, as well as MLTSS, Managed Long-Term Services and Supports. We have provided you with two brochures, so please print those out and make those available as well. In addition, we're looking at community resources related to long-term services and supports. As I discussed previously, the Area Agency on Aging, the ADRC, is a good resource to share, as well as an online guide that was created some time ago, but is still relevant, a guide to community-based long-term care in New Jersey, and a resource you too may also find helpful. So let's talk about New Jersey Family Care Aged, Blind, and Disabled programs. So we know Medicaid has multiple programs for people who need access to health care in the community or in long-term care facilities. This website here will provide you with some basic knowledge of those programs and also a resource that you could share with your patients. To be eligible for Medicaid, the person needs to be a New Jersey resident, a citizen of the United States, or a qualified immigrant, 65 or older, or determined by Social Security or the Division of Medical Assistance and Health Services as blind or disabled, and they have to meet the income and resources. And please do be aware that this varies by program and it is updated annually. You will find in the handouts a copy of the 2022 Medicaid eligibility guidelines for your reference. The financial eligibility categories for Medicaid include Social Security income, also referred to as SSI or Medicaid only. Then we have New Jersey Care Special Medicaid Program A, which also includes the fully integrated dual eligible special needs plan. Then we have institutional level, the long-term services and supports. This is where our MLTSS and PACE fall into, as well as a boatload of other programs through Medicaid. So Medicaid financial eligibility conducted by the CWA, also referred to as the Board of Social Services. The patient needing that needs to work directly with the CWA to establish that eligibility. It can be in person, it's not required. Now they do offer mail-in or online applications. To initiate an online application, the website is there. Gross monthly income and resources are evaluated. If someone is seeking long-term services and supports, they are likely to require a five-year look back of finances related to resources. See the handout, Income Eligibility Standards, which I referenced previously. In addition, there's a qualified income trust, which allows individuals who have a gross monthly income exceeding the institutional limit for which they can establish a fund to deposit the income that is above that limit. This does require that they meet the clinical eligibility requirements and their resources do not exceed the limit with a five-year look back. So ultimately, a QIT is a written trust agreement used to establish a dedicated bank. Information about the QIT can be found at this website. So please refer your patients if you feel that they might be over-incomed to the CWA, the experts, where they can provide more expanded detail. Just having a base knowledge is important to at least make the referral. Managed Long-Term Services and Supports, MLTSS. It is that delivery of long-term services and supports for individuals at risk of nursing facility placement. Managed care organizations coordinate all services and or our PACE sites. It is designed to expand home and community-based services, which is intended to supplement the assistance that is being provided by their caregivers to strengthen the ability of the caregivers to continue their role. So services can be provided at home, in an assisted living, a community residential service, or in a nursing facility or special care nursing facility. Once enrolled in MLTSS or PACE, all services are authorized by that entity. Patients already enrolled are ineligible for a hospital EARC, and a listing of MCOs is available at the following website. The Program of All-Inclusive Care to the Elderly. This, too, is a long-term services and supports program provided through Medicaid, but it does also provide for Medicare coverage as well. So we say it's a comprehensive Medicaid program that provides individuals age 55 and older with customized care that is planned and delivered by a coordinated interdisciplinary team of professionals. They must meet the nursing facility level of care and live safely in the community at the time of enrollment and reside in the service area of a PACE organization. Today, we currently have 6 PACE organizations serving 11 counties, and the contact information is available online here. We also have a listing here that provides the different counties that are covered. All active counties are in blue. Under development, we have in light blue, pending counties, and then expansion counties, where current PACE programs are expanding into these other counties. So community resources related to long-term services and supports. I'm just going to keep saying aging and disability resource connection, 21 county area agencies on aging. They do conduct screening to determine potential and clinical eligibility for Medicaid and other community-based programs and services. This is an appropriate referral for patients not eligible for hospital EARC and or NIF transfer. There is an online resource, and as I said, there's 21 county AAAs/ADRCs, and here is a listing for you. So let's get into the EARC. We're just going to review each section of the EARC and make sure you have an understanding of what coding would be required for this. So these are all the sections of the EARC, and we will be discussing each. So this first acknowledgement section, it just kind of identifies different considerations for the hospital EARC screener. As I'm looking at this, I see we have not updated this with our changes that we discussed earlier. So please know that this will be updated. But ultimately, the screener just needs to check that you acknowledge all of the requirements are met, and then just click Save and Next. The hospital admission, this is the date that they were admitted to the hospital, not the date that they were in the ER, but when they actually became a full admission. The hospital name will populate, and if you have multiple hospitals in your network, perhaps there may be a drop down here. And then the county should also auto-populate. The request type should be identified. So let's see. Yeah, I already discussed that. All right. So the request type identifies the type of EARC you're requesting, whether it's a nursing facility transfer or a vent SCNIF. If ventilator SCNIF selected, ventilator dependency must be selected as yes in the medical section. And just be reminded that any other SCNIF placement does require that on-site assessment. The identification section does provide for the demographics for that patient, and this is just a visual of what it looks like in the portal. So we're looking at the legal name of the individual and other demographics. Please ensure that all demographics are correct, social security numbers, date of birth, making sure that the date of birth is not the date of admission and vice versa. We do ask you identify where the patient lived at the time of the referral. You must select one. If in a facility, include the name. If they're homeless, you can select that and the hospital address will auto-populate because it is a required field. And then identify the address of residence. If residing in a facility, include the facility address. The next section is the EARC eligibility. And this is just a screenshot of how it presents. So identify if Medicaid is expected to pay for any costs of the NIF stay. If yes is selected, it's necessary to inform the patient that Medicaid financial eligibility is required to be established. If no is selected, a prompt will appear to inform that hospital EARC is targeted to an individual that may be Medicaid eligible, not yet enrolled with an MCO, or who may be in a Medicaid spend down. You can still proceed, but ultimately we're looking at the EARC being submitted for those that are potentially seeking Medicaid eligibility. So if they're private pay, they have no intention of applying for Medicaid, then the EARC would not be indicated. The next question asks for you to identify the patient applied for Medicaid and is the application pending. If yes, you can identify the date. You can also identify unknown if the date is not readily available. You do need to manually input the date. There's no calendar data date entry available. If no is selected, ensure they have been informed to contact the CWA to initiate that application. The last question for this section, identify the patient funds, expect to last less than 6 months in a nursing facility. This identifies those who may be in a Medicaid spend down status. I said it was the last question, but I'm wrong. It was the last question on that section, but the financial eligibility section then goes into review the income and assets. And again, you're not conducting the financial eligibility, so your best guess is good from the information that you're gathering. We're ultimately just looking to identify if their income is at or below the required limits. So that's what these numbers represent. Please do know that the income does change yearly, so we do try to make sure this is current and up to date as soon as the information is available to us. So financial eligibility information as requested, this does require you to communicate with that patient, the options counseling that we discussed to get a better understanding whether or not the target criteria is met. Any questions from the patient or their representative regarding that financial eligibility should be directed to the CWA. And again, their contact information is here, a full listing of the 21 counties. The monthly income. New Jersey Family Care Special Medicaid program is maximum at or below whatever that current Medicaid guideline is. Medicaid institutional cap at or below that current guideline, or their potential to be eligible for that QIT. Just to reiterate, income includes any earned or unearned income such as Social Security, pensions, earnings, salaries, tips, interest, dividends, and rental income. Identify the patient's spousal status, married or single, and current resource value. If no spouse is in the community, they're single, and their resources are at or below the current Medicaid guideline. Identify if they're a spouse, if they have a spouse in the community and the resources are at or below whatever guideline that is, consider as a Medicaid spend down if no spouse in the community and resources at or below. Assets are anything that can be converted to cash, such as checking or savings accounts, certificates of deposit, retirement accounts, and cash value life insurance. So our next section is the medical, and this is just a snippet of it because there are a few questions that follow. So if the patient has a catastrophic illness, a debilitating and or chronic illnesses affecting functional support, functional status that may require long-term nursing facility stay, this just requires a yes or no. Ultimately, we would be expecting a yes response here. The next items asked to identify a minimum of one diagnosis impacting the individual's functional status, requiring that transfer to a nursing facility. So this means that it is not necessarily the reason for the hospital admission, but it's the reason they need to go to rehab. Also to note is that ICD codes are not appropriate. Please do write out the diagnosis. If the patient is ventilator dependent, we're just looking for a yes or no. And then moving into our next section, medical PASAR. Well, this is the bottom half of the medical section, PASAR, and this is what it looks like, the best that we can do to get it in there on the screenshot. Just to reiterate, PASAR is a federal law that's mandating all Medicaid-certified nursing facilities may not admit an individual with serious mental illness, intellectual or developmental disability, or other related condition unless the individual has been properly screened, evaluated, and determined to be appropriate for nursing facility placement, regardless of the payment source. So at one point, we did stall the PASAR as a result of the public health emergency, but this has been reinstated as of November of 2021. If you need access to any PASAR specific information, training resources, you can find them at this website. So the PASAR level one should be completed prior to the initiation of the EARC, because if we do have a level two and it says requires specialized services, then that individual would not be eligible for the EARC. Please know individuals returning to the same NIF do not require a new PASAR level one. The most current version of that form can be found at this website. So as far as documenting PASAR, we're looking for the date and outcome of the level one. If the outcome is selected as negative, no other PASAR input is required, you'll see a skip pattern. If any positive outcome is identified, then you will have to proceed to the following items. So any instance of a positive level one screen requires that level one form to be attached at the time of submission of the hospital EARC to OCO for processing, and the level two if it's indicated. So if PASAR is not applicable, which means that they're returning to the same NIF, then that returning to same NIF will auto-populate because there is a PASAR on file at that NIF. No other PASAR input is required. There will be an auto-skip pattern. This is the only instance in which PASAR would not be applicable. Please know that the facility and the address listed in the identification section must coincide with the facility the patient is expected to return to. We know we have those instances of a 30-day exempted hospital discharge as it relates to PASAR. So if the physician has certified that as such, we need to identify the date the level one was forwarded to the level two authority. Even though you're not required to do a level two, the level two authority is expecting to receive that level one. If no to this question, then you will proceed to respond to the remaining PASAR items as applicable to the level one. So our level two date and determination, if positive MI document applicable items, same for ID, DD, RC, or both. And again, we're looking for the level two determination to be attached at the time of submission. Please note that all attachments must be attached in PDF format. Moving on now to our cognition and ADL self-performance. We'll be spending a bit of time in here because this is the crux of what the level of care eligibility is hinging upon. So it's very critical that you fully investigate these items and code based on what is actually occurring for that patient during the time span that's indicated for each of the items. So to do that, you need to review all available documentation and communicate with applicable disciplines, whether it be the physician, the therapies, nursing staff, aides, etc., so that you have a full understanding as to how that patient is functioning cognitively and with their ADL self-performance, and it's typically over the last 3 days. Keep in mind, a skilled need alone does not make an individual clinically eligible. And, you know, it's the skilled need along with the cognition and ADLs that does make somebody eligible. Skilled need doesn't have to be present. But if they have a skilled need, then cognition and ADLs would be a factor in that determination. So let's talk about cognition. So cognition is used to determine the individual's actual performance in remembering, making decisions, and organizing daily self-care activities. We're looking at daily decision-making, short-term memory, and making self understood. So we'll go through each of these items and the coding for each. Daily decision-making is defined as how that person makes decisions about organizing the day. So we're looking at considering the actual performance in making everyday decisions about tasks or ADLs, and determining if there's a mismatch between abilities and the current level of performance. So when we're looking at daily decision-making, we can consider how they're choosing items of clothing, knowing when to eat their meals, using environmental cues to organize and plan the day, awareness of strengths and limitations, making prudent decisions of how to respond to an emergency, and/or the need to use assistive devices appropriately. So this does require your full understanding of an individual's involvement with day-to-day activities and their decisions. So interview and observe, consult with the caregivers and direct staff, and review whatever records are available to you. Your questions during options counseling can certainly help aid you in understanding their decision-making ability. The coding for daily decision-making is identified here, and we will be defining each. So when we talk about being independent with daily decision making, we mean that they are making decisions consistent, reasonable, and safe, and there's no intervention from others to make decisions or provide any supervision, as there are no safety concerns. Decision making ability is fully intact. Modified independence represents someone who has difficulty in new situations only. They could potentially be challenged with decision making only when faced with new situations, but is still capable of making sound decisions in most instances. Minimally impaired represents specific recurring situations where decisions become poor or unsafe, cues and supervision necessary at those times. So because of their cognitive issues, they have an increased incidence of making poor decisions, requiring supervision only on occasion with different circumstances. May be independent with some areas of decision-making, but not all. Moderately impaired identifies those who make decisions that are consistently poor, unsafe, cues and supervision required at all times. Severely impaired never or rarely makes decision. There is no occurrence of any decisions being made by the patient. All decisions are being made by another individual. No discernible consciousness. The person is non-responsive, unable to be involved in any decision-making process. And keep in mind, if you do utilize this coding, expect all ADLs to be coded as total dependence or activity did not occur where applicable. And I make reference to locomotion here because somebody who is non-responsive, we would not be expecting them to be moving about. Our next item in cognition is short-term memory. We are defining this as a person being able to recall items after 5 minutes. So how is the individual responding through the assessment process? Are they not remembering your discussion that you were just in there? You were discussing nursing facility placement. They're answering questions inappropriate or not remembering your name. So if you have any questions about short-term memory, you can always do a structured test of short-term memory by asking 3 unrelated items and have that individual repeat those items back after 5 minutes. Our coding for short-term memory is yes, the memory is okay. The patient is able to recall details within a short window of time. Events of yesterday or failure to conduct a task outside of 5 minutes should not be considered as a memory problem. As well, if you do the memory test, if they cannot remember all 3 items, then you cannot document short-term memory okay. Our no would represent where there is a short-term memory problem. The patient is unable to recall details within 5 minutes. This may be realized with that 3-item test, and they can't remember all the items. Or taking into account the patient's repeated questions for information in a short time span, but not recalled. Our next cognitive item is making self understood. How well is that person expressing or making themselves understood? However able. So we're looking at the ability to express or communicate requests, needs, opinions, and urgent problems, and to engage in social conversation. So this can be via speech, writing, sign language, or a combination. It's not meant to address differences in language understanding. So your observation of interaction during this interview with the patient is required. This is the coding for making self understood, which we will be defining here. If you're documenting understood, it means that they are expressing their ideas clearly without difficulty. They're able to communicate without any question of what is being expressed, no need for others to prompt or anticipate needs. Usually understood represents difficulty finding the right words or finishing thoughts. Perhaps a delayed response, but given time, they require little or no prompting. They may be challenged to a small degree to express self, but ultimately able to be understood with little or no prompting. If utilizing an assistive device to communicate or speak in another language, they are usually understood. Often understood is defined by a person having difficulty finding words or finishing thoughts. Prompting is usually required. So they may be able to initiate communication, but it's difficulty fully expressing thoughts without prompting. If they do utilize assistive devices or speak in another language, they are understood after being prompted. Sometimes understood, they have limited ability, but is able to express concrete requests regarding at least basic needs, food, drink, sleep, and toileting. They can only communicate basic needs and or utilizing noises or hand gestures to make themselves understood. Again, if they're utilizing assistive device or speaking in another language, they are sometimes understood. Rarely or never understood, at best, understanding is limited to interpretation of highly involved, highly individual, person-centered sounds or body language. They are not actively and or effectively communicating. For those instances where expression may have occurred, it's incomprehensible. The caregiver has learned to interpret person signaling the presence of pain or need for toileting, as an example. Okay, our activities of daily living. Let's get into defining these and go over the coding. So, ADLs are defined as what an individual is able to do for themselves, self-performance, and the support provided by others over the last 3 days. These are the ADLs that we consider that are within the EARC screening. Please keep in mind that bathing is over the last 7 days. All others are the last 3 days. Also, when we consider these ADLs, we have to look at all the subtasks that are involved to make up that one ADL, and we will be going through that to some extent. So let's start with bed mobility. We define this as how an individual is moving to and from a lying position, turning from side to side, and positioning their body while in bed. It does exclude transfers in and out of bed, as we will consider that ADL in the transfer. Considerations would include alternative sleeping considerations, such as a lounge or jerry chair. Subtasks for bed mobility would be lifting self up in bed, reach or using the trapeze, raising and lowering side rails, managing bed controls, moving bed linens, and propping pillows. Level of support required. You need to determine if the person is self-initiating. Do they require cues, oversight, supervision? Placing items within reach, are they getting physical support in any subtasks for bed mobility? We'll go over the coding later. Transfer, how an individual moves to and between surfaces, including to and from a bed, chair, wheelchair, or standing position. Excludes transfer to and from the bath, that will be considered as part of bathing, or transfer to and from the toilet, as that will be included in toileting. The subtasks for transfer include positioning of the individual in preparation of the transfer, ensuring the presence of necessary equipment, and locking brakes when assistive devices are used. And again, your consideration of the level of support requiring to determine how best to code that ADL. Locomotion is defined as how an individual moves between locations on the same floor. So this could be somebody who's walking or wheeling. So if they are in a wheelchair, how self-sufficient are they once they are in that chair? The subtasks may include availability and use of assistive device if necessary, maintaining a steady gait or balance if walking. And again, your consideration of how that task is being handled and all of the subtasks that may be involved. Dressing. For dressing, we do include upper and lower body. So we're trying to understand how the individual is dressing and undressing. This would be a hospital gown, street clothes, underwear, and does also include prosthesis, orthotics, fasteners, pullovers. Please know that we do exclude adjusting clothes before, during, and after toileting. That will be part of toileting. Our dressing subtasks would include gathering appropriate articles of clothing, their ability to dress and undress, handle buttons, fasteners, zippers, prosthesis. And again, considering how they're conducting that task. Eating, how well that individual eats or drinks, regardless of their skill, includes nourishment by other means, such as tube feeding, parenteral nutrition, IV fluids, etc. Subtasks include opening containers, cutting food, bringing food to the mouth or other means of obtaining nutrition, and monitoring for safety. And then again, your considerations for the level of support. Toileting. This includes toilet use and or transfer, how that person is moving on and off the toilet or commode, how uses the toilet room, which could also be a bedpan or urinal, and cleanses themselves after toilet use or incontinent episodes, changing their pads, managing their ostomy or catheter, and adjusting clothing. So our subtasks would include gathering toileting items, adjusting clothing, changing pad and undergarments, and our coding considerations. Bathing, how an individual takes a full body bath or shower, includes transfers in and out of the tub or shower, and how each part of the body is bathed, would include arms, upper and lower legs, chest, abdomen, and perineal area. Please know this is the only ADL that we are looking at a 7-day look back. As well, we are also excluding washing of the back and hair. Please keep in mind that our bathing locations may include tub, shower, a basin or sink, or bed bath. Subtasks include gathering items, safety getting into and out of the shower, physical process of washing and drying the body, and overall safety awareness, as well as our coding considerations. So let's get into the coding for the ADLs. So we have several selections that we'd like for you to be well-versed and understand the definitions for each. So with ADL coding for all of the ADLs, independent would mean that individual is conducting that with no help, setup, or oversight. You're not looking at them, not talking to them, you're not touching them. They haven't been cued or assisted with the task in any way, doing all of the activity alone. And I do like this picture of this gentleman with the walker. He's using this assistive device along with the guy with the cane, and they're not getting assistance. So that assistive device is allowing them for independence. So independence would mean no assistance from anybody. Setup help only identifies a level of support where articles or devices are provided within reach of the individual. There's no look, no talk, no touch. You're just setting them up and they are conducting the process for themselves. Some examples: cutting up meat, providing grooming articles, retrieving clothing, providing wash basin and other bathing necessities, providing incontinence supplies, raising a bed rail, handing a walker or other assistive device. supervision, oversight, encouragement, or cueing. There is observation, oversight, so you are looking and or talking, but there's no touch. You have oversight for safety considerations. The individual may require prompting, providing instructions, or cueing, but does not receive physical hands-on assistance to conduct the task. It's more of a safety precaution or an initiation to remind them to get started. Limited assistance. The individual is highly involved in the activity, received physical help in guided maneuvering of limbs or other non-weight-bearing assistance. We'll first say that guided maneuvering means to physically direct an individual in completing a task without weight-bearing assistance. So it could be a limb that's having guided maneuvering, but there's talk and touch. For this individual, the individual may be given instructions or cues, but requires others to touch and physically assist. It can be as simple as putting a hand on an individual's back or holding his or her elbow while walking. Frequently, we see this documented by our physical therapist as contact guard or hands-on assist, but no weight-bearing support is provided. Extensive assistance is when we do have weight-bearing support, including actually taking on the weight of a limb by one helper, where an individual still performs 50% or more of subtasks. So there's talk, touch, and lift or shift. There's one helper providing weight-bearing support for all or part of the activity, although keep in mind that individual is still highly involved in the activity, completing 50% or more of the subtasks. Now we're splitting hairs here, but it's really critical. Maximal assistance. We are still looking at weight-bearing support, including lifting limbs by 2+ helpers, or weight-bearing support by one helper for more than 50% of the subtasks. So we're talking, touching, and lifting or shifting. The individual is minimally involved in the activity where others are completing 50% or more of all the subtasks. Total dependence is where an ADL is being conducted by another, the full performance of that. The individual is not participating in any part of that activity. And again, we're considering all subtasks. If the individual does perform any part of the activity, then total dependence should not be coded. Activity did not occur. It was not performed by the individual or others, regardless of the ability, during the entire period. Keep in mind, when you do document activity did not occur, you lose consideration of that ADL for potential authorization. So please make sure, if you are documenting this, it is a true reflection that the activity for that particular ADL was not conducted. Our coding guidelines, and this is really critical to consider the coding. We're looking at the ADL self-performance by that patient during the last 3 days, with, of course, the exception of bathing, 7 days.
This conference will now be recorded.
Okay, so continuing with the coding guidelines, we're looking at the ADL self-performance during the last 3 days, except for bathing, the last 7 days. Considering all episodes of these activities, including the subtasks. So if the person is requiring the same amount of assistance for an ADL on all 3 days, then we are going to code at that level. Otherwise, we're looking at the 3 most dependent episodes of assistance and coding for the least dependent of those 3. So our next slide here provides a decision tree for you. So did the activity occur during the specified time frame? If yes, then you're going to make a determination if they occurred at the same level of assistance. If it was no, then it would be activity did not occur. So if it was the same level of assistance, of course, you're going to code for that. If not, then you're going to necessarily split all the episodes across several levels of assistance, determining the 3 most dependent episodes of assistance. Did the person require the same level of assistance for the 3 most dependent episodes? If no, code for the least dependent of those ADLs? If yes, then code at that level of assistance. So we do have an example here to further demonstrate that. So if we had an individual with 10 episodes of transfer over the last 3 days, 6 of those episodes, the individual required no assistance, which would be independent. They required 3 episodes requiring contact guard or limited assistance, and 1 instance in which weight-bearing support by 1 staff was required with extensive assistance. So we're looking at all of these instances, determining the 3 most dependent episodes, then coding the least dependent of those 3. So taking that example a little further, 10 total episodes, 6 were at independent, 3 at limited, and 1 at extensive. The 3 most dependent episodes are 1 extensive and 2 limited. Use the least dependent of the 3 for coding a particular ADL. And for this example, the coding would be limited assistance. Refer to your handout. We do have practice activities, ADL coding, for additional guidance for coding requirements so that you can get comfortable with that. The next section of the EARC is the options counseling. We have various items here, and this is how it presents within the portal. So recognizing options counseling is essential for this process to ensure the screener is appropriately identifying the target population. We do allow those instances where options counseling cannot be conducted and certain items may be left blank. So options counseling allows for the patient, family, or authorized representative to be informed of the completion and submission of the hospital EARC for potential Medicaid eligibility, allowing for understanding of the hospital EARC process as a screening tool only for potential Medicaid clinical eligibility to enable that transfer to the NIF, ensuring that they understand the requirements for full Medicaid eligibility, such as the need to complete their application at the CWA and the need for a full clinical assessment for Medicaid clinical eligibility following their admission that is approved by the Office of Community Choice Options. So one of the items here is patient choice of setting, which must be identified as either nursing facility or subacute nursing facility placement, subacute representing short-term stay, select yes or no. Provider feels there is potential for discharge to the community in the future. Patient family expresses interest in returning to the community, and was a referral made to the county ADRC/AAA. Those are yes and no responses. So identify who options counseling was conducted with. If it is the patient, the name will auto-populate. Otherwise, you are required to document the name of that individual. If by chance you are unable to conduct options counseling, there must be a valid reason, whether it be due to patient cognition and lack of family legal representative involvement, pending legal guardianship, etc. The remaining sections here can be left blank. The attachment section is utilized for attaching positive level 1 and, when applicable, the level 2 determination or other documents that you feel might be relevant. We will be discussing this later. As I mentioned earlier, PDF files are required to be uploaded to the file, to the portal. The review section gives an opportunity for the screener to review and edit any information that was documented, and we'll discuss this later as well. The attestation section must be completed by the screener, documenting their name as their portal account login. So it has to be what your portal account is identified as, the screener certification number, which is the first 3 letters of a last name, followed by 3 to 4 digits, the telephone number of the screener, any comments that may be relevant, as well as the discharge location. And the comments are utilized to expand on information not covered within the screen. They are not required, but if you do want to add some information there, it can be useful. And the discharge location, if it's known prior to the EARC, it would be helpful if you could include that, although this is not required. All right, now that we went through the full EARC form, the screening, let's discuss the portal, provide an overview, and also discuss the full EARC record. So our EARC screener portal is built in a software application called Salesforce, and we are using this to enable web-based portal functionality for many of our current processes. This hospital EARC is phase one of an expanding project to integrate all of our processes into the platform. In July of this year, we implemented the NIF portal for nursing facilities to submit their notice of admission and other NIF-specific request types directly through the NIF portal. Any EARC that is conducted, a nursing facility is looking for that valid EARC to link it to that new LTC2 notice of admission. So Salesforce security standards, the portal is built and maintained on the Salesforce government cloud. It is HIPAA compliant and all those other specs and detail that are over my head. The division's cloud infrastructure is a platform encrypted environment. Data at rest and transit are both encrypted. The portal is part of our Division of Aging cloud infrastructure. And both the EARC portal and the EARC application have a role-based security from ground up, which ensures users only see information created by their organization. Some internet browser considerations. This is a web-based application requiring a browser page to refresh to view most current activities, such as the status updates. The EARC screener portal can be accessed through Google Chrome and Microsoft Edge. We do not support the Internet Explorer or other browser types. They are not recommended. You may be able to log in, but you may not have full functionality. So please do not use anything but Google Chrome or Microsoft Edge. You may want to consider turning off any save and fill addresses in your browser settings, as well as turning off the pop-up blockers from browser settings. I would strongly advise that you turn off the pop-up blockers so that you can get timeout warnings and things of those nature. So the portal access and login, it is processed by our EARC registration support team. It does require valid hospital EARC certifications, so following through with this training is necessary so that you can gain portal access. Any forms required for portal registration, the portal user access request form, is emailed to this EARC registration following the training. And it looks like I have some addresses to update here. Sorry about that. Because it's dhs.nj.gov. An initial access welcome email notification is sent directly to users, which includes the EARC screener portal link and a username. Once we have completion of this training and submission of the access request form, links will be forwarded for a competency test. And once that's conducted, the portal access will be processed. Frequently, we hear that users are not getting their emails, so please check your junk email before contacting our support team. It is important to note that users who are not active in the portal within 120 days will be deactivated, requiring resubmission of a new SF2 portal access request. This is a sample of the email that you can expect to receive. I believe the information that they're providing now has been expanded. It should also include your user ID along with the account, the hospital account name, as well as some other relevant information that would be useful, including a generic link. The generic portal link is really important to understand. This link is what you need to access the portal following your initial access or following a password reset link that was provided in an email. Those emails are a one-time use only, so please copy this email, this web link and paste it into your favorites so that you can have it easily accessible to you. Portal users do have the ability to reset their own password. Keep in mind that after three failed attempts to log into the portal, there's a 15-minute logout window before another login attempt can be made. This also includes any attempt at a password reset. You have to wait the 15 minutes before you can conduct a password reset. But to conduct a password reset at the login screen, you just click Forgot Your Password, enter your user email, and then select the user ID, and then await an email from Salesforce, which will include that link for a password reset. Keep in mind that the password is required to be reset every 45 days. The application does time out after a period of time of 15 minutes. Our pop-up blockers must be turned off to view the timeout dialog window. If you do miss this timeout warning, the application will not function as expected. It is advisable to conduct a browser refresh to determine if it is still active. If you are timed out, you will be brought back to the login screen. Otherwise, it'll keep you on the same page or the section prior if you're in the midst of creating a new eARC. So the following slides will be discussing portal navigation. So just know that if you see an A slide, it just represents a visual of the portal and the B represents the actual details. So our main landing page, once you log into the portal, this is where you will land. And the portal is designed with case statuses and things of that nature that we'll be discussing here. So let's see. To the left, upper left-hand corner, there is this quick links launch button, and that's where you would initiate to gain access to initiate a new screen or to get instructions or other valuable resources that we've placed there for you. The case status tabs are used to filter the cases by outcomes. The app type, always for you, is Hospital eARC. Search by allows an individual to access individual records, limited to the last 2,500 portal records. The eARC deep search initiates the eARC portal for all records. And grid columns.
This conference will now be recorded.
The last thing to mention here are the grid columns. This is a quick reference to basic demographics for each of the eARC records, including current status and last update. So searching for records, to conduct a search, you can use the search by, as we just discussed briefly. There's various criteria that you can search on. Once you enter a search criteria, whether it be the confirmation number or the person's name, you click the search all, and that will search all statuses. If you use the deep search, you can find specific records as well, searching all statuses. So if you don't know a current status and you just want a listing of any eARCs that were processed through your hospital, you can click the search all and it should create a listing of all those records. If necessary, then you can go and do the various searches. It's important to point out that clear search is indicated anytime you've conducted a search and want to do a new search so that it reloads itself. So the case status, each eARC will have its own record and will be stored under a specific status tab based on the current processing. You will start by highlighting the status tab where the record will be located. If the status is unknown, highlight all tabs. You can use the search by to select a category, including name, confirmation number, and date. Deep search when more than one case status is highlighted for searching. And unfinished, you must select checkoff box to enable the incomplete tab. And we'll be discussing incomplete, finding the unfinished incomplete a little bit later. So accessing the eARC record following the selection of the status tab and or use of the search, The records will appear in the grid listing and display the information specific to each record. Any of these columns can be sorted in an ascending or descending order simply by clicking the column headers. Each listing within the grid represents one hospital eARC. The number of records required for any patient depends on the number of eARCs that were created for that individual through your organization. The user can customize the number of records that will be displayed, although the default of 10 comes back when you conduct a page refresh. To access any record, once you have it visible to you, you would just click the record line to open that record. So this is the eARC record. Once you've clicked to open, you will open to the application view. We also have application update tabs, application attachments view, and OCO determination. The header of the record defines the certification number, the patient name, the provider, and the application type. And then all of the submission detail in the application view would be displayed here. So all of this information is what was inputted by you, the screener, and is reviewed by OCO support staff following receipt for processing, and then again by the OCO reviewer for their determination. We do have a read-only access following submission, except for two instances. If we have a case status update by support staff to inappropriate referral, incorrect data, only the demographic detail will be open for edits if this status update occurs, requiring the screener to save changes to access, to save the changes before any other steps. We'll review that later as well. Also, the RFI request for information, all coding fields are open for potential modification. Once changes are saved and the record is closed, any open fields will be closed for further edits. The application update, this is where the various stages of processing will occur, as long as a history of that processing. So our application update tab does provide an area, and you should be familiar with this because if you have to respond to an inappropriate referral or an RFI, you would need to then update the status to return it back to OCO. So that's where that is conducted. The app status, there is a history listing that identifies the various processing steps and the time for those status updates. In addition, the app status identifies the most current status. If assigned for OCO review, we'll identify the clinician. The status history identifies the last update to each status. The RFI identifies RFI with comments provided for related details specific to the request. The original screener will be identified. The RFI respondee to identify self at time of the response. The next section of this page, which both the RFI and the inappropriate referral were not visualized on the prior screenshot, but the inappropriate referral identifies the reason with comments providing for related detail. Anytime there's updates on this page, a save of that page is required. The attachments view tab of the record will list all documents attached as well as the submission the eARC submission detail. So it provides a listing of and makes available any documents submitted with the eARC, as well as both the submitted and finalized eARC with OCO determination. And it does provide ability to attach additional documents when requested. Our OCO determination tab, this is where the outcome of the review is documented. And so we have our OCO reviewers that will be inputting in this section of the record. So we have an outcome of authorized, including date and valid through date, which is 10 days. Not authorized, OCO will schedule an on-site clinical assessment or referral dismissed with the identification of the reason for that dismissal. Comments will also be included to identify additional detail. read-only access for the screener for this tab. And once identified with a determination, no reviewer or screener action required for processing. The portal will generate an email directly to the screener to alert you. So let's talk about the navigation as required for navigating through the process of creating a new eARC. So instructions are available through the eARC portal landing page, quick links. It's that three-lined button up in the left corner. Once you click that, you will be brought to the quick links. And here you'll see the new hospital eARC screening. That's what you would click to initiate, as well as having available to you a resource tab that provides various resources. So throughout the tool itself, should you see any icon with an eye, that just identifies information and it will provide some expanded language for your understanding. Creating a new hospital eARC, as I said, you have to open the quick links, click the new hospital eARC to initiate the process. So after clicking the, Once you initiate it, the hospital eARC will open in a new browser tab. So you will be required to complete the eARC in full with required PASSAR and other documentation as applicable prior to submission. If you're unable to complete when initially created, you may return later to finish that eARC for submission. So this again is just the navigation portion. We will not be running through each of the items, but to get through the acknowledgement page, you do have to click the little box here and then click Save and Next to proceed to the next section. So just to point out a little navigation considerations, the left navigation pane will display all of the sections. You must fully complete a section prior to advancing to the next. A section identified with a check does represent that the section was completed with no errors. Once you are in the actual application, all of the pages will have a previous, a save and next, and a cancel screening. So the previous will return you to the prior section. The save will check that current section for any errors. The save and next will check for errors as well as advancing you to the next page, and then the cancel screening. So perhaps you initiated a screen and realize it's not necessary, so you can cancel the screen at any time. If you do select this, you will be prompted to confirm your canceled request. So some data entry guidelines, date fields, you can input them manually, although there is a calendar entry for you to be able to document that. Date of birth requires the month and year input first, followed by the day. Date of Medicaid application requires free text. Dashes and slashes insert automatically. Drop down data selections versus free text entry will be clearly identified. And then, of course, we have some areas of auto population based on your account. And whether or not, if they're identified homeless, the hospital address will populate into the identification section. So, validation checks and error messages. As I discussed, save or save and next will check for any errors. Error messages typically appear at the top of the screen. Sometimes they also are indicated following the item. Some are just reminders. So if you can't proceed, chances are you have an error. So go to the top of the page to understand what that error is so you can move past it. Our attachments, if required, a listing of required PASSAR documents will be provided. So for this example, we have a need for a PASSAR level one attachment. So it is identified here for us with a pending status. The type of other will always be present, but it is not required. So you don't need to worry about the other. So to attach, you're going to select the document from the dropdown, put a descriptor in there, which would be your own text, and then browse your computer for the file that you're looking for. So we have the PASSAR level one attachment. I just documented that out again. You could put the name of the individual, that's fine. Choose your attachment, go into your computer, browse for that, and then you hit the attachment button. Any attachments will be identified at the bottom of the screen. And this is the process for that. It's pretty straightforward and standard to the normal attaching documents. The final review section is critical for the screener to just verify the detail that they've inputted and apply any edits if necessary. To edit, you can simply click the edit button or go over directly to the section that you wish to make an edit in. Any changes must be saved followed by returning to the review section so that you can then proceed to the next steps. So the attestation does require you to put your name, your certification number, telephone number. Comments, as I stated previously, is not required, but if you did want to add any information, please do so. And then the discharge location, which is very helpful to OCO for follow-up purposes. Once that's done, just to reiterate, the spelling of the name and certification number must match your profile. So in the top right on the homepage, the main landing page, you'll see your name displayed there, as well as when you're in the screen, it'll be documented. The certification number is typically the first three characters of the last name, followed by 3 to 4 digits, and then the rest of the detail. Once you click Save and Submit, you will get a confirmation page, which lets you know that this has successfully been submitted. It will provide the date of the submission and the ER confirmation number. You do have an opportunity to print the application, although it serves no purpose at this point because there's no determination on there. So typically you'll click Complete to close the record and return to the main landing page. Okay, so if you're looking for that EARC after you're going to want to conduct a browser refresh to see any new activity. It's a web-based application, so you want to make sure that it's been fully loaded into the main landing page. So click that browser refresh to see any new activity. Now, typically, it's going to go into a submitted status because it's going to OCO now for processing. So if you're looking for that, you may want to select the case status of submitted and get a full listing of anything sitting in that status. Otherwise, if you just click search all, then you'll get a full listing and you can manipulate the column headers to get access to the most recent submission. So let's talk about the workflow and processing of the hospital EARC. So on the main landing page, we've made reference to the status tabs. So here we have submitted, hold, inappropriate referral, assigned, RFI, RFI response, OCO determination, and complete. This is the full process of an EARC that it typically goes through. So we do require browser refreshes to see any updates for any particular record. So these are the statuses as I've discussed. What's important to express is that we will be providing email notifications directly generated from the portal for various status updates. So at the point of submission, you'll get a confirmation email that your submission went through, provides the detail that you need should you wish to access this later. You'll also receive email notifications for inappropriate referral, requests for information, and OCO determinations, and other instances where there's been an administrative action for a modified determination. The email does not provide the detail. It just identifies the status and provides the name of the patient, confirmation number, and general detail and instruction for you to go back to the portal. This is the email address that the emails are sent from, just to get you acclimated so that you're not unfamiliar. So let's talk about incomplete EARCs. So we understand that you're very busy, you get distracted and pulled away from what you're currently doing. With the portal timing out, you may not know it if you missed it, that there was some inactivity notice presented to you. So there is a way in which you can access an incomplete EARC so that you don't have to start from ground zero. Keep in mind that while you can access an incomplete EARC, those that are not accessed and submitted within 10 days are purged from the system because then they're really not relevant after 10 days. Once a screen that was once incomplete is submitted, then it would go on for processing and determination. While you can complete an EARC that another screener initiated, please be aware that you are responsible for the detail. So make sure to check all the prior coding that was presented in the screen prior to submission. So to access any unfinished or incomplete EARCs, you want to check the unfinished box that presents here. Let your browser refresh, and at that point, an incomplete status tab will be the only standing case status present. You may not see a list of anything at the moment when you click that, so click the search all and it will provide the full listing of incomplete EARCs to further complete and submit. All right, so let's move into the submitted status. As I said, the confirmation, once you receive this, this case status is updated to submitted. It's auto-updated through the portal. So submitted status represents an EARC that was submitted by the hospital screener. It's automatically updated following completion. It becomes a read-only for you at this point, although you can access the record from this submitted status tab following a browser refresh. Any details submitted will be able to be seen within the application view of that record. And the case status will remain here until OCO support staff takes their action for processing. This is the email that you receive for a submitted EARC, and it'll give you the name and the the confirmation number. So there's not really any detail in here, it just does provide some direction who to call if you have troubles or any questions. So the hold status is a case status used by OCO when additional research is required prior to processing. There's no automated email notification to the screener. So if this is a short-term status update, once processing can occur, the status will be updated as applicable to either inappropriate referral or assigned. Should be assigned, sorry. Okay. The hold status is visible in the main grid listing following a search, or if you were to just select the hold status, you would get a listing of all those. It's also visible directly within the EARC record in the application update tab. Our next case status is inappropriate referral. Any EARC submitted but not accepted for processing for various reasons will be identified. Whether there is a valid clinical assessment on file, MCO enrolled, or other, these records are considered closed. There are no EARC resubmission expected. If by chance there is a conflict with demographics, the reason will be identified as incorrect data, and we are expecting to have that EARC resubmitted. We'll be going over that here as we work through these next slides. An inappropriate referral notification will be sent to you. You can access that record from the inappropriate referral status tab, clicking into the application update tab to scroll down to view the reason the referral was updated to the status. So this is the email. The subject line will say inappropriate referral, give you the name, the confirmation number, directing you to the portal. So from the application update tab, scroll down to see the detail. The inappropriate referral detail is at the bottom of this tab. It'll identify the reason and some applicable comments. If there's no action on file, It will remain in this status and no further action by you is required. If we do have that incorrect data identified, this will require you to review and update any demographic detail from the application view of the tab. We are looking for a turnaround time of one business day for this to be eligible for resubmission. There are some navigation considerations to take into account. So if you are going to update or, well, first you have to review. So you click into the application view tab, make changes if necessary, and save those changes. We did implement a reload button to refresh the record. So once those changes are made, click the reload so that you can proceed to the next step, which would be to then return to the application update tab to then update the case status to submit it and save changes for resubmission. If no demographic changes are required after verification, include an inappropriate referral comment prior to saving this status update. And this is really critical. This is a new feature that we added, but first let me just review the application view. So incorrect data, when you go into the application view, only the demographic detail will be present. All of these fields will be open and available for edits. So make your changes, save them, click reload. Okay, so after you've made your changes, or if you validated that the information was correct, you will then go into the app status. You'll go into the application update tab to update the status to submit it. If necessary, insert an inappropriate referral response comments and followed by clicking save. This will return the EARC for initial processing. And please know that this does reset the submission timeframe. The comments here is a new feature that was added. So this allows an opportunity for the EARC screener to document if no changes were made to communicate that with OCO. And this is important to input a comment before any changes are saved. An assigned status represents an EARC that has been accepted, and there is no apparent exclusion, criteria, or demographic errors noted. It's signed to an OCO clinician, and so therefore the status is then updated to assigned. At this point, there's no further action. You're just waiting for a determination. You can see that in the main grid listing, if you were to generate a listing, or in that particular record in the application update. Request for information. This is conducted when an OCO reviewer is reviewing the EARC for potential eligibility and identifies a coding error or need for PASAR or other documentation prior to making their final determination. With this status update, the screener will get an RFI notification via email. We do expect the screener to respond within one business day of the RFI status update. If there's no response, the referral will be dismissed with an OCO determination of referral dismissed. And if a new EARC is required, a new EARC must be submitted. This is the RFI email. Again, the RFI will be identified in the subject. No details, so you'll have to go to the portal to access the record to identify the scenario. There you can access it in the application update, the RFI section, scrolling down to see what it is the reviewer is looking to express to you. If there was a coding error, you're going to return to the application view and then go to the section where the detail needs to be changed. Keep in mind that all of the data is open here. Please be mindful not to change anything that is not relevant to the request. You would just go to the section that you need to modify, make the selections, click save at the bottom of the page, and then reload. If by chance an attachment is required, you would open up the attachments view tab from the open record and insert any new attachments. It would be the same process, it just looks a little bit different. Choosing a file, including a description, saving attachments, and then clicking reload. The attachments grid listing will identify all of those attachments. So choose your file, identify the name, browse, and then attach. Following any coding corrections or adding documents, go back to the application update tab and change the app status to RFI response. Include your name in the RFI respondee field, followed by clicking save. If by chance a coding is validated as documented and no changes have occurred, we did also implement a comment box here for the screener to communicate to OCO when no changes have occurred or any other relevant information. So once the RFI status is updated, this will alert the OCO reviewer to then proceed to conduct their final review with a determination. So this is just a screenshot of the RFI info section. Your respondee name goes in the RFI respondee box, and then there are the comments. Once you do click save, those comments are forever saved and documented who actually applied those. Our OCO determination case status occurs following our screener doing their review, and it allows the screener to then proceed with next steps, with whatever steps are necessary applicable to that outcome. Authorized outcome, you're going to proceed with your hospital discharge for nursing facility transfer. Keep in mind that is only valid for 10 days. Provide a printed copy of the EARC with the OCO determination and the PASSAR level 1 and level 2 when applicable. Not authorized, you're going to await that on-site clinical assessment, conduct it within 3 business days of that original EARC submission or a referral dismiss. Determine the reason for the referral, whether it be no response to the RFI, the target criteria was not met, or other reason as identified. If an EARC is still indicated when the referral was dismissed, it will require the screener to initiate and submit a new EARC. Otherwise, there's no additional action required by you. This is the email regarding the OCO determination. It's in the subject line, same information presented. Encouraging you to go back to the portal to view the determination. Our View OCO Determination tab within the record, you want to go there to print if it's an authorized so that you can then go on to provide that to the nursing facility. So to access that, you go into the OCO Determination tab and you will have that down. There'll be Print Determination and Action button there. There are instances when a outcome needs to be changed. Perhaps there was additional information requiring modification or it was documented in error. This too will also send an urgent portal email to the screener to inform of this administrative action. This is the email that the user will get. It will be documented as urgent because it may change the circumstances of your discharge. So you must locate the record and open to determine the updated determination. So just know that this is a final OCO determination and invalidates any prior notification. It is your responsibility to update anybody for anybody that you've notified of this modified outcome. The complete status indicates that all final OCO processing is complete. The OCO support staff will update the status to complete. So keep in mind, if you've gotten an OCO determination email notification, that record may no longer be sitting in OCO determination. You may also find it in the completed status tab. It has no bearing where you find this record on the outcome, and discharge planning can proceed as appropriate. No additional updates are expected to the record. Okay, so that was pretty much the navigation through the portal. Please know that we have updated our EARC process document to include many screenshots to help with navigation through step-by-step along the way of the process. So please use that as a handy resource in addition to this PowerPoint. Our next section here we want to discuss is the hospital EARC certification process and initial portal access. So any hospital EARC screener, hospital discharge planner must be a social worker or a registered nurse. It's the responsibility of the hospital to validate the credentials of those individuals seeking certification. So this training is serving as the initial EARC certification. It's available online as you have access to anybody seeking new certification. We do require recertification every 3 years, and all currently certified screeners are asked to access a new training as being posted the day that this was also posted. While the certification is valid for 3 years, we are asking that all screeners currently certified have recertification as we have conducted some updates to the portal and process. Keep in mind that if you are certified and you leave a hospital system and you seek employment with another hospital system, you are still certified and can gain access to another hospital. Just submission of a new portal access request is required, so keep that in mind. OCO does reserve the right to revoke a hospital EARC certification for anyone not meeting quality assurance standards for accuracy. So our next steps in this process is the EARC competency exam. So the competency exam is conducted through SurveyMonkey. To gain access to the exam, we first require that you submit the SF2, the portal access request form, to our EARC registration email. The SF2 is a new form, and it is available on the DOAS Provider Resources webpage for you to access. This form should be completed electronically in full with signatures. Manual signatures are acceptable. When you send that into us, please include the subject line EARC certification, request for competency exam, include the full name and email of the screener, the hospital system employer, the name of the supervisor, and date of EARC certification training, the date it was accessed. Upon receipt, our support team will provide a SurveyMonkey link directly to the EARC screener, the potential pending EARC screener. The exam must be completed in full, accessing the exam only once, and we require a 79% proficiency to be processed for a valid certification. Anything less than 79% will require the potential screener to retest for competency. So once we have successfully completed the exam, our registration team will send an email directly to the newly certified EARC screener. This email will provide the EARC certification number. Please take note of this, as this will be required to input into the EARC at the point of submission. The certification number is typically the first 3 digits of the last name, followed by 4 digits. Once we have achieved EARC certification, the request for portal access will be forwarded to Salesforce, who will then email our new EARC screeners to get that initial access welcome email the next business day. Any requests sent on Friday will not be processed until the following Monday. Our initial link expires within 24 hours in that email, so your immediate action is requested upon receipt. That email will contain your user ID and a link to establish the portal password. That link is a one-time use only link, and any subsequent logins must be used through the generic login link. Please copy this and paste to your favorites. Portal support, most importantly, please review your training material and seek support from power users within your organization to provide for direction and to assist with issues prior to DOAS outreach. For navigation questions or to report issues, send to the EARC registration. Include your name, hospital, and as much detail surrounding the issue as possible. Also, screenshots are very useful and help us to better understand what is occurring for you, and also allow us to understand the root of the issue, hopefully resolving it in a timely manner. Any questions regarded to EARC processing to specific EARCs shall be directed to the respective OCO office. And here are their numbers for you. I thank you for attending this training. I hope you found the information useful, and please do access this as you consider the competency exam and as you process through your first few EARC screenings. Thank you and have a great day.